the state of affairs
and the climate movement.
We actually have rehearsed this because we just got together this moment. So, and so Bill will talk about that for a moment, and then Luisa will talk for like 10 minutes or so. And then Luisa, and then John, and then Jamila.
Is this working?
Yes.
Good. Well, look, Sabine, thank you so much for having us here. Thank you so much for having us here, Sabine. And what a pleasure to be in a room filled with people, many of whom I know, who have been doing great work on all of this for a very long time. And what a pleasure, Luisa, particularly to have you here with us. I will say, certain ways, it's an embarrassing moment to be welcoming people to this country. I was up half the night working with colleagues around the country, trying to figure out, and I may not be in very good shape today, because I'm trying to figure out some kind of response to what's happening in Springfield, Ohio, where there are apparently Klansmen in the streets, and people breaking windows, and terrorizing people, and they're calling it a kind of junior league sort of crystal mock kind of moment in this country. And it's terrifying and sad, and just a reminder that we work in a time of many, many, many tensions cutting across each other. Many things that we have no choice but to try and figure out how to respond to. The deepest, most underlying problem, of course, that we face at all times is the climate crisis, and there are two things. I'll just make two observations as we start today. The first of those is that we're obviously in a world of hurt. The things that we were warning about 35 years ago when I wrote The End of Nature are now the things that are coming true. And it's, I must say, absolutely not the slightest pleasure to be proved correct in all of this. One wishes just the opposite. As you know, the last 18 months have been a kind of breakout period for the temperature on this planet. After a steady rise, we've seen a sudden and dramatic spike, first in ocean temperature and then in land temperature. The temperatures beginning in about June of 2023 and continuing through the present have been the hottest temperatures ever recorded on this planet globally. Our records go back about 200 years, but scientists are good at building proxy records that go back much further, so we're confident that what we're seeing is the hottest weather in at least 125,000 years on this Earth. 125,000 years ago was the moment, the anthropologists tell us, when people started etching symbols onto bone. So really nobody that we would really understand as a human society has ever lived on a planet as hot as the one we're now living on. And of course, the results of that are increasingly obvious everywhere with the just endless drumbeat of storm, flood, fire. Having your back of your thoughts today, the people out in Southern California trying to figure out how to evade the fires raging there right now. So that's one half of where we are. The other half of where we are, and it's coming at exactly the same moment, is that we're finally at the place on this planet where we're seeing the rapid beginning of the rapid deployment of renewable energy. It's interesting, the same weeks in June of 2023 that saw those hottest temperatures ever also saw for the first time the planet go past the point where we were installing a gigawatt of solar panels a day, so roughly the equivalent of a nuclear plant's worth of solar panels daily. That's now down to every 18 hours or so that we're doing that. Half of that's in China, but that leaves still a considerable amount in the rest of the world too. It's not going fast enough to catch up with what we need to be on some kind of Paris pathway. The IEA, International Energy Administration, says we need to roughly double the pace at which we're doing that, which would be very hard. But it's not also an impossible or outlandish kind of number to be aiming at. We look around a place like Massachusetts and understand that we should be able to double that pace, pace we're going at here, pretty profoundly. So that's the race that's now underway. And it's always important to remember that it is a timed race. It has a finish line, and the finish line's not very far away. The IPCC has told us that we need to cut emissions in half by 2030 to have some hope of staying on that Paris pathway. 2030 by my watch is 5 months, 5 years, and 5 months, or 4 months away now. So that's extraordinarily hard. It would be very hard even if we all were working in good faith. One of the points I think of today's gathering is going to be that large parts of our society, the fossil fuel industry, are not working in good faith. So we have to constantly be figuring out how to break their political power and make it possible to move at the speed with which we need to move. But I think that's just the kind of bare outline of where we stand at the moment. On the one hand, it's the worst news of the last 35 years, and on the other hand, we're finally in this fight in a way that we haven't been before. And I'll just finish by saying, if you want a sense of what that could feel like, I just did some writing for the New Yorker about what's been going on in California this year. Californians have worked as hard as anybody outside China or Germany to set up solar panels and batteries. And they finally got enough up on the grid that for long stretches of each of the last 100 days, California has generated more than 100% of the electricity that it uses from renewable power. That means that at night, when the sun goes down, batteries have become the biggest single source of power to the grid. And that means that year on year, California is using 29% less gas to power the electric grid, 25% less natural gas, 29% less natural gas than they did a year ago. So a 29% fall in the course of a year is a number large enough to begin to put some kind of dent in what so far has been the kind of endless trajectory of CO2 upward in the atmosphere. It's as hopeful a number as I've heard in a long time, and our job is to figure out, I think, one of our jobs, how to make that happen as widely as we can. Another way of looking at it is just to say, we stand at the moment when it's possible to imagine that human beings could end their 700,000-year-old habit of setting things on fire, which has been the underpinning of human. Darwin said, language and fire were the two things that marked our species. It's been good to us until it wasn't, and now it's not. But happily, we live precisely at the moment when it's completely possible to imagine that the sun, already gives us warmth and light and photosynthesis, could provide the power that we need to run the civilizations that we have built, and that we could do it in short order. That's a potentially powerful and beautiful moment in the human, in the sort of story of human evolution as a civilization. And I think that I'll just say, as I finish in terms of strategy, we've built this movement largely on the backs of anger, guilt, fear, and sadness. Those are appropriate, powerful, strong emotions that we've made good use of. probably also now need to build it on the back of a certain amount of hope and romance and adventure. And I think that that's entirely possible. This is the greatest project of its kind since the moonshot in the 1960s. That was about putting two guys on a different planet. This is about bringing a different planet down to our own so that we can use it to make possible the continuation of life on this Earth as we have known it. So there I stop and pass things over to my real friend, someone I have. I hope you people understand, everybody understands. Well, it's such an honor to have everybody up here today. But since I'm passing this to Luisa, I'll just say I've known and worked with her for a long time, considering how young she is. And she has been absolutely instrumental in the European climate fight. There's an enormous amount that wouldn't have happened over the last 4 or 5 years without her. And the thing that I've always admired most, and I think why she'd be so helpful to us here today, is that she's managed to balance the activism that's necessary to build new power with the responsibility necessary to use that power in real ways at the highest and most important levels, government and elsewhere. So she can and has done it all, and so a true pleasure to get to pass things over to you, friend.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much for making this happen, for coming, for providing everything that is needed for a day like this. It is a real honor to be here, and I have to mention that I'm having a bit of a full circle moment right now, because it's been exactly 10 years ago that we met, because I was working at a newspaper back then just after high school. I was 18, and someone called me up and said, can you do an interview with this environment guy from the US? And I had never done an interview, and I didn't know Bill, and so I was obviously overqualified to do that. And I sat down with Bill, and in Sweden it was actually. And by that time, everyone was talking about climate deniers, and in Germany and many places, people were really like, they just couldn't like believe that people here wouldn't believe in climate science. It was so odd to us. And I remember asking Bill, like, what do you do about these climate deniers? Like, how the hell can you be an environmentalist in a place where every second person by then, I think, challenged science as a thing? And Bill said, and I will never forget it, Bill said to me, Luisa, I am not so worried about the 50% not believing in climate science. I'm worried about the other 50%, and I'm wondering, where are they and how can we get them to do something? And I found it, yes, it was mind-blowing for me. And I sat in this interview and we talked about divestment, and I had a moment that I felt I'm sitting on the wrong side of the conversation, because there's one side who's doing something and there's one side who's documenting something. And props to all the documenters out there, but I wanted to be on the other side, so I went back and I started a divestment campaign at my university, and we did a divestment of the city that I lived in back then, and I later started even doing some student work for 350, and some time passed, and kind of the heat waves got worse, and the fires got worse, and we started the climate strike movement in Germany, inspired by Greta Thunberg, and yeah, that worked out quite well as well. But for me right now, coming back here and sitting here with all of you, it's it's a very precious moment, I would say. And maybe I talk a little about the work that we do, just to give you a little idea of what has been happening so far. This morning I talked to some of my friends back home who were experiencing what might be the worst floods of Central and Eastern Europe in modern history. And my friends who had just been on a weekend vacation to Vienna saying they wouldn't make it home. And people in the Czech Republic are being evacuated and are lacking electricity. And this is in an area that knows how a flood works. And it's, you know, it's been talked about for days now that this flood is coming, and still it's still overtaking anything that people have imagined. And I think that is one very symbolic thing we're experiencing, real life events that are overtaking our own imagination, our own planning. We just cannot imagine what is coming, and it's still coming despite all the amazing math and science that we have to hand to help us imagine those things. But it's just out of this world in every way. And at the same time, some other friends of mine are organizing the next climate mobilization happening next Friday. And it's one of many mass protests that we've been organizing throughout the last 5-6 years. We have organized our government in Germany to introduce the first ever climate law, which is a huge step in a very fossil fueled country. We organized our country to exit coal energy by 2038, the latest, which is too late, according to the IPCC. It's too early for many in the government to think differently. But it's also an incredible step for a country that has been rebuilt after the Second World War, after fascism, based on coal energy. So when we speak about fossil fuels, about coal energy in a place like Germany, we never just talk about a source of energy. We talk about a culture, we talk about an identity, we talk about who are we and what makes us strong and powerful, what runs the economy, what provides jobs. Many things that I feel like are a bit similar in this place. And so we organized for policy changes with mass mobilizations with especially young people in 300 towns across the country, bringing up to 1 million people on the streets on the same day. But we mostly, I find, and that I think is worth mentioning, we mostly organized a cultural shift, a normative shift. We challenged on what is a good life, what is wealth, what is progress, what makes us free and what doesn't make us free. And because what our governments under Merkel back then did do wasn't enough, we sued our government in front of the Constitutional Court in 2020, and we argued that we as young people are being repressed in our freedoms because governments that would delay climate action would harm our future freedom because they would put additional catastrophes in our lives, but they would also force us to implement so many things at the same time, the little time we have left, because they're being lazy right now. And absurdly enough, we won that case, and we have a German Constitutional Court universally declaring that climate inaction harms freedom. And I do find that striking because we see so many people arguing against climate action in the name of so-called freedom. You know, we can't do this to the people because they have the freedom to do whatever. And this court ruling doesn't just apply to Germany, it's universal, and it really challenges this idea of what makes us free, what makes society free, and what do governments have to do in order to protect that very freedom. And I want to, I'm mentioning this because I want to give it to you, take it and run and, you know, use it against any other policymaker who runs around claiming that you can protect freedom through climate inaction. And now we had and now probably most of you will have seen the debate, the Trump-Harris debate the other day. And there were two moments in it which I found quite meaningful for this day today. Number one is, after this debate, dozens of my friends from Germany, from all over Europe, they called me up and they say, why wasn't there more climate in it? Why weren't they more talking about the climate, you know, the whole fracking thing? Well, but the people were looking at this, watching this from the outside, and they're wondering, where's the climate movement? Where's the climate people? And I find it's a quite important reminder to say, whatever happens here, not only in those debates, but on the streets, people are watching. People from all over the world are watching. They're taking this as an example of how to fight in very difficult times, under very difficult circumstances. People across the world want to know how to withstand the Trumpist climate denial culture out there and how to organize for something more powerful. And if nothing happens, people still see it. And people will also take that as an example of ignorance, an example of looking away, of an example of staying away from something that matters to us. So it's not just the outcome of an election of a very difficult time, but it's also the very outcome in the stories that are being written on the streets but what is being visible that people take from and learn from in either way. If good stuff happens, people will take it and use it. If bad stuff, but also if kind of nothing happens, people will also take that. And it matters for so many people who aren't in this country, who aren't in this room. And I find, kind of closing up to what Bill has mentioned, there was another moment in it. And it was a moment that Trump, in his very last statement, said, you know, take Germany as an example, something about clean energy. And our foreign office smashed that lie, because what actually has happened in the past 5 years is quite a different story of one of the biggest economies of the world, the strongest economy of Europe. The story has been written of that very economy turning away from fossil fuel as a whole successfully, without any blackouts, without any people screaming and shouting on the streets, without any pets and dogs being eaten or anything. That story has been written, and it didn't fall from heaven. That story is man-made by hundreds of thousands of people that are just much more than just me sitting here telling that story. And, you know, when the statement came and when our foreign office reacted saying, like it or not, we are leaving fossil fuels behind because there's something much more beautiful at hand and we can do it and we can provide a safe environment for people, that was a success story for so many. And I found it was such a historic moment that someone wanting to lie about clean energies on public TV had to actually tell a lie about something that is in the past, because the reality has overtaken these autocratic fossil fuel ideologies. And even if you look closely, you will find that even in Hungary under Viktor Orban, there are solar panels being put up. Yes, so much for my side, and now I'm really excited for today. I'm excited to learn from you so much about how to keep things together, how to unite behind these things, and I don't want to put additional pressure on this room, but really people are watching you guys, people are watching us, so let's take it seriously. And now over to John, who had his birthday yesterday, so a big applause for him. Yes,
very happy to pass it on to you. Thank you very much, Luisa. I'm just glad you didn't mention my age, because really I'm not as old as I look. This white you see here, I just forgot to rinse the soap out this morning, that's all. So that's not, age is just a number, it's just a figure, but it does not be an indicator of, as they said in James Bond movie, of efficiency, you know. And past President Ronald Reagan said, I won't hold his youth and enthusiasm against him if he won't use, and his inexperience against him if he won't use his age against me. So it's all commensurate. We all have something to contribute and give to this movement, and it's going to take all of us. This is an all hands on deck moment, and we all have to be a part of it. So first of all, I'll start it off this way. Howdy, y'all. Good morning. All right. I'm from Texas. I don't have a twang, so don't say that. But I'm from Texas, a little city called Port Arthur. And when you see it on the map, you'll know it immediately, because it's where Texas, Louisiana, and the Gulf of Mexico meet. And that's little old Port Arthur, a city of 57,000. But Jefferson County has a significant role in the petrochemical landscape. Also, I'd like to thank Sabine and others who invited me here to come from the great state of Texas. Matter of fact, I just left Washington, where I was giving testimony before the House Natural Resources Committee because of permitting reform. And basically, they want to get rid of two major things in that landscape: NEPA, Natural Environmental Protection Act, and also the CEQ, Council on Environmental Quality. And my words to those congressmen and senators, the congressmen that were there, was this: we can have jobs and opportunity, but not without getting rid of environmental protections that protect communities like mine and others all across the country. So let me give you a little bit of the landscape of Port Arthur and what it is. I told you where it's at. But the industry, as we know it today, began in 1901 with the spindletop Lucas Gusher. If you look that up, you'll see it. That picture went all over the world. And the guy that took that picture came from Port Arthur. Can't think of his name right now, but that's where he came from. He was a photographer. That picture's been everywhere. And by 1903, The first refineries were built. One is Beaumont, Texas, 20 miles or so to the north of Port Arthur, which I formerly worked at. Yes, I'm former industry and I'm former, I'm a former member of the labor unions. So I'm second generation union, and I'm also second generation petrochemical worker. And they also built two refineries in Port Arthur. The Texas company, which became Texaco, which is now Motiva and the largest refinery in the country, and Valero. And there are other numerous chemical plants, at least four chemical plants, other processing plants and others. But here's the impact they have on my community. Because a vulnerability study was done recently to show that we have some of the worst air quality in the country. We're in the 95th percentile. That means only 5% of cities in this country have worse air than we do. And it's because of the emissions that come from these plants. And how do we know that? Well, it's also manifested in our quality of life, but more importantly, our quality and state of health. Because our cancer rate is twice the state and national average. But it also, we have high rates of lung disease, kidney disease, and others. I've lost very dear friends and relatives that worked in the petrochemical industry and didn't get to retire. Matter of fact, one of them, Terry Fleming, was told he had maybe 4 weeks to live, 6 weeks to live. He got four, but he spent the last three of those four in intense pain and under heavy sedation. So he never got a chance to retire. And then there are some that have died while they were working. But all that is to say this, that the impact of this industry, which is the engine that drives this economy, is fraught with environmental abuse. It is also fraught with racism and environmental injustice. And it is also fraught with climate change, which we're all experiencing. You all just heard recently about the storm that came through and hit Louisiana, and it put us all on alert. And that's something we have to live with in Southeast Texas. But we also understand that it's as extreme as hurricanes can be. You can also have floods. The largest flood that was recorded in the country is recorded in the Port Arthur area. Almost 5 feet of rain, over 5 feet, slightly over that, of rain fell in that period from Hurricane Harvey. And Port Arthur, once again, is the poster boy for it because in the last 17 years, we've been hit by five major hurricanes and had a brush fire of at least that many more. So we have to look at those climatological impacts. That's one of the things, the cumulative impact, and also the unintended consequences of our continued reliance on fossil fuels. Why? Because it is the driver that not only drives the economy, as I said, but it's also driving the change in weather and climate change. But one would also think that as these companies move in and expand and do more, there are at least five or six proposed projects in my area. And so we fight those things. We push back on, if I could coin the words of my old company, it says they take on, Exxon says it takes on the world's toughest energy problems. Well, my little organization, the Port Arthur Community Action Network, takes on the world's toughest energy companies, and we win. And most recently, we won a case back in November against the third LNG that's trying to come into our area. Two of them are in Port Arthur's boundary. And just right across Lake Sabine from Port Arthur is the third, which is one of the largest exporters of liquefied natural gas to Europe and to Germany. So in fighting this company, we got a ruling from the U.S. Fifth Circuit Court in New Orleans, which threw out their air quality permit. So they're trying to build and construct as we speak now without a permit. But then now we're going to be going back to the state Supreme Court for clarifications on a very narrow ruling. And hopefully we'll win that case too. And now we'll be able to make enforcements on the company, stop the construction of it, and also force the enabling agencies like the DOE and also FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, to revoke those permits, stop the building and construction, and do this thing the right way, because they would not take into account the environmental considerations that they're having on our city. They're saying, oh, the emissions will just be a little bit, it'll be a little bit. But how much is a little bit, and how much damage it will do? We cannot take jobs and opportunities and make them the poster boy for what we want if it's going to hurt people. If you're going to do it, no job should do harm to anyone, especially people that don't work in the plant. I can understand if you did, but when it goes outside the fence line and it affects people to the extremes of having cancer and other diseases and illnesses, then it's the wrong thing to do. So I went to Washington to fight for that. I'll be going back again really after tomorrow for more work on Capitol Hill, but the work never stops. We have to push back, we have to fight back, and be strategic in how we do it. So as we go through this, hopefully we'll get a chance to tell you more about the work that we're doing. But we take on those challenges because life has meaning, and people's lives matter, and their voices have to be heard. And communities of color, BIPOC communities of color, don't get many opportunities to be heard. But we have to constantly work at this, engage those people in decision-making capacities and that are doing things to harm us and our communities with a rising level of involvement, engagement, and pressure. We have to make them do what we want them to do. So once again, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to you. I'd love to chat with all of you here before the day is over. And I'm now going to pass the microphone on to Jamila.
You may have noticed I was furiously scribbling here because there's so much that this conversation is provoking for me. Well, I want to start by thanking my fellow panelists, Bill, Luisa, and John, very much, and as well as the organizers for inviting me to be part of this conversation. So I'm not from the climate space. My organization and my work for more than 20 years has focused on nonviolent resistance more generally, social and political change for a variety of ends, and how to make those struggles more effective, with the idea that we have this incredibly rich history that hasn't been very well documented, and that gives most of our societies the idea that change and the achievement of our freedoms and our independence was done through violence. And that's true here in this country and also the country where I was born, Afghanistan, during the Soviet invasion and occupation of the country. So I've been thinking about issues of human rights and oppression and injustice for a very long time, since I can remember. And the being born and during such a violent and brutal period that the country faced, and obviously that was the start of decades of more violence and oppression that continues until today, left me with a few kind of general sense of, first of all, helplessness and powerlessness, that things could be done to my community. There's not much we could do in response except for violent resistance. But also that people were not going to give up that violence for nothing, that they needed a powerful way to defend their communities, that telling them violence is morally wrong wasn't very compelling for them. So I got left with a feeling of really glorifying resistance violence, and I think most of our societies do that. And so for me, it was, what are people supposed to do? Are they supposed to give in? So it really kind of sparked in me this need to try to look for alternatives and for powerful ways to fight. So my family was involved in the resistance, the anti-Soviet resistance, but also I had an early kind of introduction to climate because they said that actually climate was very much related to the effect of war on societies that were getting their land polluted and that was causing massive deforestation and was leading to all these other problems. And of course people told them and told us that actually worrying about climate is a luxury when you're fighting for your life. When you're in these extreme circumstances. I mean, all these years, and that's in spite of all this impact that the war had on the climate. And I mean, they're still saying it's a luxury. I mean, they're probably telling some of you all, it's a luxury given that there's poverty and oppression and democracy's under attack and all of these other things. But of course, we know that that's not right. So just some kind of general thoughts. My fellow panelists have been really specific and really talked about the scale and urgency. I think everyone in this room understands that very well, and I think people in our larger society also are beginning to wake up or understand the scale, and there is so much science and there is so much information. Yet many of us continue to think it's an information problem, right? That people, if they only just knew how bad things were, you know, they would go out and save the day. But we know actually it's more than an information problem, it's really a power problem and a tools problem. And so, you know, maybe that should give us a clue on to really how we should also, use our own efforts. So there is you may all be familiar with this Lancet study from a few years ago, which said that something like 75% of young people are scared for their futures. 45% of those say that the anxiety and the powerlessness is actually affecting their ability to function and live like normal lives. And obviously that's really sad. Part of it is not just how bad the problem is, like, you know, climate is very scary, but actually the idea that leaders have betrayed them, it's the sense of betrayal, that our leaders have failed, that they haven't acted to protect our communities. So I wonder though if this, you know, I mean, it's sad that there is this powerlessness, but and this kind of waking up to the scale of the problem. But I also think of it in terms of a silver lining. I mean, if we realize that our leaders aren't gonna save us, maybe that means we have to do it ourselves. I heard this, I watched a movie recently. It said that someone said, the biggest threat to our planet is that we believe someone else will save it. And so maybe we're realizing no one else is gonna save it, right? So there's that moment of opportunity. But obviously what happens next is so far from inevitable. Because it is just a moment of awareness, and I study these moments of mass mobilization or mass awareness in terms of, you know, anti-dictatorship, anti-authoritarian struggles, and you see this increased mobilization. People are fed up. There's a trigger moment, and it's a major opportunity for recruitment to the movement. And I think that's what we're seeing. But some of the research we're looking at, you may be familiar with this, is that people are activated and fired up, they're mobilized more than ever, but we're actually less often achieving concrete victories, at least on the scale that's required. So mass mobilization is up, there's more nonviolent action in the world than ever before, but it's less effective. I was recently part of a seminar of people trying to understand this dangerous trend, and there was so much focus on opponent innovation. This idea that the opponents of these struggles are who might be targeted by movements for change are actually preparing and planning. They have massive access to resources. And so we're facing really powerful opponents with huge capabilities and the means of repression as well. Control over the economic system and the police and the prisons and the justice system. So what are we to do, right? But then I think there's another piece to this. And that's that this excessive focus on opponent innovation and how powerful the systems are is actually demobilizing. And there's more research that says that as well. Actually, we don't have much control over how the opponents innovate, and it's only natural they're going to want to defeat these movements. But what we do have control over is our own movements. And we have to recognize there are gaps in our capabilities. We have to recognize that we have not been as strategic as we could be, as coordinated, and also that we've often, you know, focused on disruption and mobilization at the expense of really building truly powerful powerful organizations and networks and communities. If you look at the movements throughout history, and I promise this won't turn into a lecture on nonviolent resistance, I'm speaking to a very engaged and thoughtful and informed group here. But I think the best movements in history have recognized that if you're withdrawing from unjust systems, you have to build the alternatives. And so when we talk about strategy, it's about the need to build power and not just withdraw from systems. To imagine that future and to be able to clearly articulate it, it has to stem from a vision of how we see the global climate justice movement. And how we as Massachusetts, how we as Boston, or wherever we, whatever community we're from, fit into that. Some people think that when we talk about strategy and coordination, it means we have to have some kind of super strategy with a charismatic leader that tells us what to do. that's obviously not realistic, and that's actually not what we want. That's not going to be what's effective. It's really about building mechanisms for sharing information, for documenting what's working, what isn't working. There's so many successes, so many that I've learned from Luisa in the years that I've been friends with her, but that I've never heard about, that we don't hear about. And I think part of it is we think if we haven't achieved our whole win, we haven't solved climate, that means we really have no right celebrating until, you know, until we achieve the big win. But that's actually very counter-strategic. So again, how do we, you know, how do we design resources and trainings and education and capacity for these decentralized movements that need to be effective in their communities, but also fit something bigger, because our movement is transnational. And so there'll be opportunities to talk later on, but I'm so happy to be part of this group and to to have this time to think deeply about, you know, the issues affecting us, and look forward to hearing from all of you.
So for those of you who walked in not quite knowing what to expect, I hope that you understand now what powerful wisdom we have in the room with us. So thank you all four of you, for laying this out so powerfully. I want to introduce another young voice, Lana. Taffel, come on up. Who's going to start us off with questions and is going to help me keep you all involved in the conversation. Lana, come on.
Hi, everyone. So after I ask a question, we're going to go around and open the floor to the questions that everyone else has. And it would be great if, when you get the microphone, you also just tell us who you are, where you're coming from. So I'll start by saying a little bit about me. My name is Lana. I'm a senior at Brandeis. I'm also studying German. But I also have had a climate activist journey myself since the age of 16, and have worked on climate activism a lot in Massachusetts. So thank you so much for all of the insight you've provided so far. My question relates to my personal experience as a climate activist, and having done 5 years of climate work, I know how exhausting it can be and how difficult the fight is. And I just wanted to ask, you know, we talked a lot about how the opposition, there's a lot of focus on the opposition, the climate deniers, but really it's the people that are inactive on climate, the people that care about it but aren't really doing anything about it or sort of resigned to what's happening. So my question is, how do we activate the people that are inactive, especially in this moment where there's sort of a lull in the climate movement? If anyone wants to start.
Perfect question.
Thank you.
Yes. I feel in climate spaces, and you might have heard this, in climate spaces, people often say, we shouldn't be preaching to the choir. And I'm like, well, preaching to the choir has gotten the churches quite a long way, you know? Kind of worked out for them. And why is that? Because people dared to establish a powerful culture, a powerful identity around people who were doing the job, and made sure that there was a constant space provided for people who, you know, tend to get very exhausted by that work. And it's easy to kind of, you know, take people who are doing something for granted and getting all worked up on someone who's probably never going to do something, while forgetting that those running the place, they need support too. So when we talk about how to recruit people, how to get people to get started on something, the first thing we as a movement tend to think about in places like Europe, places like Germany, is like, what do people need who are already doing something? Because they're quite a good source for that. And one thing we found, number one, is we don't, as a movement, we don't want to put people in a place where they have to decide between having a good time and doing something meaningful. So we, as rule number one, whenever we create a space, we need to make it somewhat fun. Not all work is fun, you know, it can't be the expectation, but it needs to be a place where people really generally want to go, even if the climate crisis didn't exist. And so this means we put a lot of effort into community moments, into making sure people constantly learn something because people want to learn new stuff. And so we try to figure out how to, you know, build capacity to get something about something that people are generally interested in and curious about. Number two is we try to figure out how to get people outside their comfort zone. So we took a lot of recruitment ideas from Bernie Sanders, actually, who was very, by the way, he again thinks traveling globally. It was very inspiring to us in our small little children's rooms in Germany what Bernie Sanders did in his recruitment, because we found if we ask people to do one tiny thing, you know, do this little thing, they might as well not do it because, you know, nobody's kind of excited about doing this tiny thing. But if we ask people for the world, people, some people might drop out, but some people get really excited about it. So when we organize a protest, so we wouldn't ask, hey, who wants to sign up for the newsletter? We said, hey, who wants to go to another protest? And then people said, yeah. And then we said, and who wants to organize that next protest? And people were like, ah. And we were like, awesome, you're recruited. We're doing the next one. And when people came back and said, yes, I brought a friend to this protest. You know, we always said, bring a friend because everything is more fun with friends. We always said, bring a friend. Which is awesome because usually those friends weren't active before, but bring a friend has been working out so much. People would come and they would say, hey, I brought a friend. And we were like, awesome. And next time you bring your entire school. And they were like, excuse me, what? And it turns out if you have two friends and someone challenges you to bring your entire school to a climate protest, you are very likely to succeed in this because it's an adventure. It's something that you haven't done before. It excites you. Doing this tiny thing, you know, that doesn't excite you, that just feels like a burden, that's another chore you have to do, tends to not excite people. You kind of do it because you feel guilty or, you know, it's kind of this charity thing, but you don't feel like there's a mission in it that could give you something back. So we dare to ask people for something bigger, that is bigger than something they've done previously before. And the great thing is people love talking about stuff that they did. Then people love also talking about stuff they failed in, which is also great, but people also love talking about stuff that worked out well. So you suddenly have the greatest storytellers around who run around saying, you know, I did this great thing. And suddenly people are like, oh, sounds like I could do that. So maybe that's as a start. We create spaces that are fun. We ask people to bring their friends or relatives because, it, you know, make sure new people come, but they have somewhere to go to. And we dare to ask for things that are fun, that are exciting, and that are less than the bare minimum because, you know, who wants to go out for the bare minimum?
Yeah. I think what you said at the end there is especially true. And I was thinking about it when Jamila was talking because, you know, the greatest nonviolent leader of all time, came from her country, Taffel Abdur Khan, who organized the Kudai Kitmatgar, the great nonviolent army that Gandhi said was the greatest example that the world's ever seen. And these were people who were signing up to die, and did in very large numbers. We don't have to do that, but there is something powerful in asking people to do something commensurate with the scale of the crisis that we're up against. And I've noticed over and over and over again, I wrote the letter asking people to come to Washington at the beginning of the fight against the Keystone Pipeline, which some people in this room answered. And it was the first big civil disobedience action of the climate era. And people had no idea if it was going to work at all. People responded in huge numbers. And this continues to this day. I mean, great shout out to the 600 or 700 people who've been to jail so far this summer in New York City outside Citibank, doing great work. You have to have not a mask or jail, but you have to have a fight. That's how, you know, humans sort of get interested in things. There has to be something to fight. And the outcome, the stakes of that fight, you have to have a fight that A, you can plausibly win, and B, that if you plausibly won, the effect would be large obviously the tactics change a lot and do different things, but figuring out ways to put people in situations where they can do more than they thought they could is a very powerful thing.
Well, just a couple of thoughts. I think a lot about, you know, designing resources for exactly the group that was described. People who understand the need for action, but then need to figure out how to act in a way that is truly effective. And it brings to mind a conversation I had with with an activist, or he probably wouldn't really identify as an activist, as a citizen in Iran, that said that, you know, the movement has been dealt this massive repression, it's gone completely underground. Well, it looks like from the outside that it's collapsed, but actually, just because people now understand the cost of going out in the streets doesn't mean that they don't retain the kind of desire to change the society there. They're still, like, they've gone underground, they're trying to figure out how to organize, they're trying to figure out how to access knowledge, they're trying to figure out how to come back stronger than before. And he says, you know, the problem is that the cost of the repression is so high, or the cost of organizing or linking with anyone else is so high because of the repression. Anytime that you talk to anyone about the need for political change, you could be reported on and end up going to prison. So that's Iran, right? We don't have those levels of repression, thankfully, yet in our own societies. But there's still a cost for organizing, especially for people who don't necessarily understand how what they do can matter. You know, it's not just about belief in a cause, it's also about the means used. You have to have confidence in those, and also confidence in yourself that you can actually contribute to them. So without kind of these three pieces, you know, just belief in the need for change isn't enough. So I think a lot about you know, our Iranian friend, about, you know, the cost of organizing is very high in a society like that. It's pretty high in ours as well, because we're constantly told we should kind of just trust in the system, that change is not possible, that our way to do it is by voting every 4 years. Otherwise, we kind of sit back and relax and let the leaders, whoever they are, take charge. So for me, I think a lot about education and training. And I think when you recognize the need to do something, then you need to figure out what are your options and then how to carry out action effectively. We need a way to kind of assess the strategic logic of our actions and how to do that in a way that's accessible to people, and how to really decentralize these processes. We can't wait for kind of the emergence of any centralized leadership. It's just not possible, it's not realistic, but we still need to act effectively. So we work a lot on those tools. I think those that field of study is also expanding, this kind of education training space. We need to continue to improve it, because people have lots of energy and then they still need a way to kind of incorporate planning processes, reflection processes. You know, how do we figure out a campaign we did and assess whether it actually worked? Using actual metrics of, did it grow power for the movement? Did it undermine it for the opponent? Did this fit a larger strategy? Have to be asking those questions constantly. And I truly believe that mobilizing people means, you know, making them feel like what they can do can work. It's really a question of efficacy. And I think, as you know, when we're improving the efficacy of our movements, I think that is the biggest thing that's gonna draw people to our movements. And we can't lose sight of that.
Maybe if we take a couple of more questions before we continue.
Yeah, we can do that.
Questions. Okay, maybe we'll start over here.
Hi, I'm Becca Glenn. I am the Massachusetts State Manager for Mothers Out Front. My question kind of goes along with Lana's, but from a slightly different tack. I think when, you know, they do polling of, you know, do you care about the climate? Is it something, you know, our numbers are quite high, but then when you ask folks in the U.S., what is the number one issue that you think is most important for your voting, for anything else, it's actually quite a small percentage. And I think it goes along with what Jamila was talking about as far as, you know, folks are facing these other existential threats, like I'm trying to feed my family, etc. And it's a luxury, and I'm interested in the panelists' thoughts about how you get past that and how you talk to folks about why this should be at the top of their agenda.
I'm going to answer your question, but also I'm going to go back to the previous question a little bit because I had something to say about that. How many of you all remember the miracle Jesus worked with feeding the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes? Okay, well, we're in that kind of moment right now because people are hurting, and just as you said, they are concerned with the existential part of living, trying to keep the lights on, trying to pay your bills, sending your kids and children to school. And a lot of times, they simply just don't have time to focus on that. So what we have to do is, like Jesus did, feed the people. We have to address their needs. And once you address the needs that they have, then you can engage them about this movement and how they're a crucial part of it. But we have to serve and work on behalf of those people in those communities. We have to give them help and hope to feel that somebody cares enough to reach out to them wherever they are. Port Arthur, out of 57,000 people, two-thirds of them are what we call economically disadvantaged. That number looks like this. That means that that's a family of four living on less than $35,000 a year. Low to moderate income. But we also have 27% of that population are below the poverty line. That's that same family of four, but trying to exist on less than $21,000 a year. Now imagine trying to do all you have to do and pay bills and those incidentals, and you know it's always something going to happen, the unexpected, and not have to do it. So you're concerned about the day-to-day, but if we can bring them some relief, if we can give them some help where they are, then maybe we can bring them along. And in doing this work, we can't just do it the standard way. We have to think out of the box. We have to go into the high, not get off the highways and hit the byways and the little small streets and alleys. We have to go where they are and mobilize them and energize them, get them enthused and understanding that they have a part to play. And that in playing that part, they help the bigger picture of successfully getting out of fossil fuels and into clean, green, renewable energy, which is better for the planet, better for them, and better for their children.
Just adding a thought maybe, I think one is really connecting the issues. I remember, I'm not familiar with American space, but I'm just going to say, please be kind. So with the vaccine thing, okay, it's a difficult space in Germany sometimes. So I remember one of the most successful governmental schemes in Germany wanting to get people vaccinated that were kind of often, you know, in very difficult, segregated areas that wouldn't have access to like the healthcare system in a, you know, normal way and so on. One of the most successful things they did is offer free sausages for everyone who would get a vaccine. Because these were moms who were working their asses off to feed their children, and they would have to, if they did this journey to the vaccination center, that would take the time that would usually take to go to the cheapest markets, to do the calculations, to get the children here, whatever. So to fit that into their busy lives, they needed to create like a co-benefit for that to make sure someone can cross off two things at the same time. And that counts for the poorest of the poor having to feed their children and wanting to get them healthcare. But that also counts for moms today who may be organized with your organization around moms in Massachusetts, who will have to take care of the children in the afternoon. So how to create a space for people to cross off the tick off the things from the list. So creating a space of whatever, finding a childcare person when you do your meeting about the climate things, or figuring out how to do like a friend's hangout barbecue after your climate protest. So people will have a moment to talk to their friends and do something, you know, thinking about co-benefits in times when people just have multiple worries. But also maybe just one thought about this idea of the rankings of issues on the country. And I'm really skeptical about that being a good way to talk about the climate or talk about people's issues. We have a similar situation over in Europe where people, you know, ask about European elections, who just went by recently, and people would list a trillion of their worries, and then climate would be number 10, and then some journalist would turn to me and say, so, Luisa, how do you plan to get the climate up the list? And I'm like, man, can we talk about reducing that list? Like shrinking the worries of the people? Shouldn't that be the number one issue? To have people less worried about a trillion things? I'm worried about rent, about studies, about economies, about my mom's job who works with the healthcare issue. I'm worried about so many things, and I would never ever ask someone else to ignore all the difficult things in life and focus on climate only. I don't think that can be any goal of the climate movement. Instead, I would think, as a movement strategically, let's think about the multiple crises that are putting burdens on people's lives and how to connect the dot efficiently, thinking about clean energy in a way to protect access to energy without autocrats interfering, thinking about creating transportation systems that are affordable to everyone. You know, strategically, I would say, let's look at those lists carefully and connect the dots. Discursively, I would say I wouldn't expect the climate crisis to be solved if this is the number one issue for everyone. Because as Jamila rightly pointed out, people who tend to be very aware of the climate crisis tend to be very desperate about what to do about it and maybe do even less about it because they're so worried about it. So I would say, practically spoken, we don't have to ignore everything else that is going on in the world and that needs our attention. But I would suggest to handle climate and ecology questions and questions of nature more like maybe we treat the question of money. So whenever there's a governmental proposal, a bill, a regulation, someone would come along and say, can we check it with the budget? Can we afford that? Does it fit in our financial plans? When we make personal decisions about our life, we would usually kind of look at our bank account and feel like, can we afford that? Does it work? Do we need to save up? How do we do it? And that, I find, is an approach that is kind of fit for the ecology too, because we would need governments, when they make a new bill, a new decision on whatever sector, on transportation, on health, we would need someone to check in, can we afford it ecologically? Does it fit in our climate plans? Does it fit in our emission schedules? If we make a plan for a new school building, someone would have to come along and not only check our financial budget, but check our CO2 budget, see, can we afford that? And I find that is something that we are so good at when it comes to money. So we could, you know, it isn't so much of a stretch to implement that on climate and ecology question, to just make sure it doesn't fit with what we have left, what there is for us to produce and to destruct. Is there that, you know, do we have the ecosystems left? And in many times we'll find out we do not have another ecosystem to destruct. And funnily enough, when it comes to money, we see governments getting very creative when it comes to spending bills and financial plans and, you know, all these things. And I wonder, where is this creativity and this eager to kind of find good solutions when it gets tight on the climate side?
Thank you so much. Other questions? Just raise your hand. I'm gonna go further back. I'm going to go all the way to the back so that everyone gets a chance to talk.
Thank you. Thank you to the panel for all these great insights. I want to first give a shout out to a particular strategy that I know is being pursued here in Massachusetts. It's called Polluters Pay. And recognizing that we're in a populist moment here and that there's a lot of people who we think of as helplessly right-wing MAGA, who would join with us, who consider ourselves more liberal, to say that, God, these big, fat, rich oil companies that have caused these problems should be paying to help solve. And so I'm wondering, the idea of weakening our opponents politically seems to be one of the major goals of that campaign. And such a campaign would, in my mind, and I think many other minds, allow for a variety of tactics, such as referendums. We give people an intermediate step as organizers to go out and stand on street corners and get petition signed and take small actions. And it could be with a refund to people who will inevitably have to pay for the higher costs of energy. I'm just wondering, how does a strategy like that to weaken our opposition fit in with other strategies that are currently being pursued? And is it something that maybe we could focus on more?
I can say a few words about this one. These make polluters pay bills, or climate superfund bills, we're calling them, are a very good idea and spreading fast. Vermont passed the first in the country, its legislature, earlier this year. The next key moment on this is coming in New York State at the moment. The legislature's passed the bill. It's on Governor Hochul's desk. We're having a kind of nationwide campaign to get people to write in and ask her to sign it. Third Act Upstate New York is helping coordinate that, so you can find that pretty easily. But it's turning into a very big fight. And the same fight is in a slightly earlier stage in California, but progressing well through the legislature. And on Thursday last, Representative Jerry Nadler and somebody, some senator or another, is that right? Chris Murphy, I think that's right, introduced it at the federal level, where it won't pass immediately, but becomes a good bill. The argument here is very easy, and you're right, it has broad appeal. Who should pay for climate damages to roads, bridges, whatever else? Should it be taxpayers, or should it be the oil companies that made a fortune, even though they knew very well that this was what they were causing? And it's a powerful, powerful argument. Obviously, the oil companies will fight it. Hopefully we can win some of those fights, because they'll probably be mostly in state court and under state law, as opposed to going to the Supreme Court, though it may well end up there. But it's a righteous and powerful fight to have. It's not unlike what happened to the tobacco industry in its waning days in this country. The only moral problem with this argument, I suppose, is that really, if we were forcing Exxon to disgorge profits and make people equal, the first payment should be going off to Pakistan and Bangladesh and the Maldives and whatever. But we don't have a system that allows that to happen at the moment. And someplace, some of those jurisdictions are in fact starting to sue as well. This is a powerful thing that should happen. And it's easy enough for legislators to persuade them to do it, because unlike a lot of the other things we asked, it comes at no particular cost to them. I'm very eager to see New York, Massachusetts, whatever, adopt it, because I know that the state of Vermont's legal department, which has two lawyers, is unlikely to be able to stand up to Exxon's over the long run. So it would be a big help to have some other people on it. New York State really is the next fulcrum here, and if you could pitch in, figure out how to send a note in connection with that, do. And I put out this free newsletter all the time, and this is one of the things that I've been keeping pretty close tabs on, so you can find out what's happening, just paying attention to it. Really important strategy. Thank you for bringing it up.
Making polluters pay is, in my mind, the way to go. The two things that are involved in that. One is the best way to get their attention, and I can get anybody's attention in this room immediately. That's one thing I'd have to do. Reach in your purse or reach in your wallet and take out money. So if it'll work on people, why not on corporations? Why not get them to do what's right? Because when you attack their money, and you also attack their name and public image, or as someone said earlier, show them the dirty business, the dirty side of what they do, because they're only going to show you, you know, the rosy picture, but we want to take off the rose-colored glasses, strip the facade away, and come to places like Port Arthur, and come to places like Lake Charles and others, where people are living in poverty and are struggling. Meanwhile, these companies are making billions of dollars, and then in turn, they're getting billions of dollars in tax breaks. Some of that money should go toward the community. We had an explosion at a plant called TCE in Texas, and massive explosion. I live 7 miles away, and it shook my house. And they received a $30 million fine for what was the findings by OSHA and others and EPA in terms of what they do. They manufacture various chemical products and make rubbers and plastic with it. It had a major malfunction, and that it was basically attributed to the lack of maintenance and the lack of good processes to not have that situation happen. But anyway, they were fined $30 million, and not a dime of it went to the community. When the state asked them, because the state of Texas has a program where part of that fine could go to the community that was affected, they didn't want to do it. So what we have to do is talk to those federal agencies to make these things mandatory. We're going to take this fine, but it's not going to go to the government and fill their pockets that are already lined. It needs to go into the communities to do more, in addition to putting fence line monitoring, in addition to changing your processes, in addition to being able to go in and inspect what they're doing, to see that they're doing it right. The lack of enforcement creates a problem. But we've got to attack the money, because when you separate somebody from their money, you got their undivided attention. And we really need to ratchet up that pressure and use that to help the communities be better and stronger.
Do we want to move on? Next question? Okay. So we have time for like one more question theoretically, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to collect three people's questions and we'll have some collective answers. Hopefully the questions will kind of relate to each other a little bit. Any questions over here? We'll do, okay. First question over here.
Hi, I have a question about nonprofits and their role in all of this. HRW, I think, did a piece on Southern Louisiana recently, and Amnesty did a piece on the Houston Ship Channel. At least one of those organizations, I'm told by my daughter, is really suffering for money. And I'm just wondering, is this part of the political climate where the money's going to politics and not to nonprofits, who play, I think, a key role in, but just if you can talk about the health of nonprofits and the importance of the role they play and what we're all trying to accomplish.
Okay, next question.
On the subject of opposition and innovation, I wonder if you have any thoughts and experiences about ways to have movements be resilient to the forces that come at us to divide us or exploit divisions and disagreements that are taking shape within those movements.
And then one more.
Hi. I was wondering about what Luisa was talking about facilitating that cultural shift here in the U.S., because I think we also have a culture here that's pretty fundamentally non-ecological. So I was wondering both how intentional that cultural shift was and sort of how you facilitated that.
So feel free to respond to what things you'd like. There's three questions on the floor, so.
I can take a try at combining a couple of them anyway. look, American culture, above all, defaults towards the individual at all times. That's our default. Some parts of that are good, other parts of it are less good. It means that when we think about something like the climate crisis, our first impulse is to ask questions like, what's on my roof, what's in my garage? Good questions. I'm glad that my roof is covered with solar panels and they connect to an EV. But we're obviously not going to solve this crisis one Tesla at a time at this point. One vegan dinner at a time, one anything at a time. The most important thing an individual can do is be less of an individual and join together with others in movements large enough to matter. Those movements are facilitated by nonprofit institutions that get that we form in order to provide people with a vehicle for coming together. And nonprofits of all kinds are always tenuous, and often the better the work they're doing, the more tenuous they are, and the harder it is to raise money and so on and so forth. We face that constantly at Third Act, which is, you know, underfunded, whatever, but that's all right. We figure out how to do what work we can. And part of that work, of course, is providing the culture of resilience that lets people have some way to stand up to those forces of division and things. One of the uses of a gathering like this one is to have people connected enough with each other that they can resist some of that division when it comes, and know who else to turn to and call on. But there is no way, I think I'm much less a historian of movements than Jamila or probably anybody else here, but I think that the history indicates that there's no way to do this unless you can figure out how to organize yourselves effectively, and probably in America, that's the most important thing, because there's so many forces in our culture that tend to point us in highly individual directions all the time.
Well, I'm very interested in the question of how to understand and counter the new capabilities and sophistication of our opponents. And I think that we also need to understand what we even mean by opponents, right? Because there are people who may be susceptible to convincing to join our side. Now, some won't. Having an understanding of society and knowing, who our opponents are, I think is important. I think figuring out what opponents means in terms of, who's really the target of our actions, who is causing the harm, who has the capacity to fix it also, right? Who are the targets of our campaigns? But the specific question about opponent innovation is, first of all, to understand the types of innovation that's happening. I think one key thing that I look at is, first of all, documenting their tactics. I found out recently that, the extreme right in Germany is actually using the same principles that we are. I'm talking about the need for developing a narrative that speaks to different people in our societies, to tell them about why the existing system is inadequate, how it's unjust, how it's left you behind, and that we, the movement, is going to deliver you a better future, this common vision. I mean, it's very, very similar in terms of looking at maybe some of the work of Marshall Gans on public narrative, together with Gene Sharp's nonviolent direct action. They have a very clear strategy. They even say so. There's this guy that we were talking about, right? Luisa, who's like leading the far right movement, an Austrian, neo-Nazi, who says that Gene Sharp has been the inspiration, the intellectual underpinning of his development of strategy. So part of it is that the opponents are becoming more strategic by using our very tools. And so we need to actually understand how they're using those tools and then figure out how to counter them. And I'm not saying there's, a clear outline on how to do that, but at least it starts with understanding it. Just to even know exactly what their strategies and tactics are. Also, they recognize, and I like how you put your question, because it's about the way in which they undermine movements. Okay, fine, they have all the capabilities, the means of surveillance, they have all of this. They also understand what decreases effectiveness of movements. They realize how to provoke disunity. They understand that provoking violence, also property destruction, that these are things that decrease effectiveness, that don't work very well in the nonviolent framework. And so they are very, very good at provoking them, understanding that they provoke them, understanding how to withstand that provocation. To me, seems like a very, very important, at the strategic level, way of countering it. And then there's all the tactical stuff, right? Often our opponents, especially in more dictatorial societies, they focus on violence or the threat of violence, also the larger issue of repression. Repression looks very different than it did maybe years ago. They're still using the kind of normal means of repression of like punishment and prisons and things like that. They're also being more sophisticated about how they apply repression. So they'll like attack your character, kind of make you feel scared, kind of draw you down in terms of like your mental health situation, and provoking disunity among movements. They're very good at that, and sometimes we do their job for them by not being prepared to withstand that. And there's so much more. I have a whole spreadsheet on documenting opponent tactics and then like exactly how they're being used and how the kind of maybe the 198 methods, if you know about that list, what is the 198 methods of the opponents?
Maybe to illustrate from the field, in terms of division, I think we have some classic examples. I'm thinking about a big mobilization. Maybe you, hopefully, some of you have seen some pictures. In last year, in early 2022, a German coal company wanted to take down an entire village to expand a coal pit. It was peacefully called the Battle of Lützerath. And it was this very, maybe you want to look it up, it was very iconic because you just had these gigantic coal diggers just right at this village. And activists have been, together with the local communities, had been kind of occupying this village, had been painting this, making it a whole place for people to come, like a, almost like a pilgrimage thing. People would come there, there were like spiritual services, and there were like family farms, and there were tents, and there were, of course, tree houses, German engineering everywhere. And you would then have this very like horrible Voldemort style coal company that, it's so easy to hate. And so people would really come there, and eventually it kind of narrowed down on this day when we knew like this coal company would come down and take down this village. And me and Greta Thunberg, we went there, and it was really from a different world. And what happened very quickly was we had mobilized like people to come. So my mom would call me up because she's in the newsletter. My mom is a nurse from, way up North Germany. And she said, my friends and me, Jutta and Ulrike, like very German moms, they were having their Nordic walking thing, and they were talking about it. And she called me and said, Luisa, should we come down to Lützerath? And I'm like, you should totally come down. And I felt like, man, we got the moms, we got the Nordic walking moms to come. Like, that's an important step to take. So she came down with her friends, and we knew there were lots of people coming to protest at a public demonstration that weren't used to civil disobedience. But you would have the people in the tree houses, and you would have some people throwing maybe mud or so at some very, problematic police forces. And you would have this real mix of methods. And we knew that by that time that this day would come, they would divide us through the methods we would use. And they would tell the protesters, the moms, you are kind of getting together with the criminals. They would tell the people in the treehouse that they were criminals. They would tell the people in the mud that they were like horrible human beings and anti-democratic, which is what they now labeled us when we asked for democratic agreements, like the Paris Agreement, to be, fulfilled. They call us anti-democratic for whatever reason. But we knew that they would divide us over the methods that we were using and wanted to play us out against each other. And what we tried, I'm not sure how successful we were, but we tried to, before any of that action happened, to talk about that, to use that moment before people arrived. And it kind of crashes an energy form because people are in the spirit, they're getting ready. No one wants to talk about strategy and tactics, and nobody wants to hear about things that could go wrong. But we try to take that time before any of that happened to say, they're gonna nail us down, they're gonna ask us, what do you think about the police exactly? Where do you stand on civil disobedience? How do you feel about that other person doing something else? And we tried, and I think that is something that we kind of take from it. We tried to anticipate that this is going to happen and use a moment when everyone is in good spirits beforehand to make sure people build this trust and say, hey, we're coming from different parts of the country, we're coming from different parts of a political spectrum, and we come with different methods, but let's build this trust in each other, to trust each other that everyone here is acting in good faith. and that the best thing we can do to our opponents there is for them having divide us so easily. And so we had this really unspoken rule of people not distancing themselves from each other. Because the first person that says, oh, I distance myself from him doing that, you know, that will they will distance, and every by the end of the day, we're all fragmented and divided. So to counteract division, I would say, anticipate it. Use a moment beforehand. Same maybe in this room. There are so many different organizations. That's great. But I imagine it might make it hard sometimes to come together as mass, I don't know how to pronounce your state, as mass people. And it might make it difficult sometimes to unite, you know, to say, hey, you know, do we fight that, do we fight that, do we fight that? When you're here together today, anticipate that. That at some point, people might come and say, oh, no, what they are doing, what they are doing, and I can't sign up to this because I've signed up to that, and why are they getting funding, and whose logo is that? You know, all these difficulties. Anticipate it and remember it in that moment where you know it's crunch time, you know the people, call each other up. Say, we are from different organizations, but also we all like that same local beer. You have your very nice local beer. I had some of that yesterday. You know, remember those human moments when it like when it's getting tough. Sorry. And when and of course, I think maybe just one popular other thing that they try to do is to, you know, lift some on the extent, like expense of others. We had a very nice, fun campaign against Siemens, which is a big German company, who thought it was a sensible thing to do to provide some infrastructure for a coal mine in Australia. And Siemens is a very proud German company, you know, very big, many people, many jobs. And so we went against Siemens, and the CEO of Siemens invited me and another friend over to have a conversation. And we said, that's awesome, you know, let's talk about these coal issues that we have. And the CEO of Siemens, Joe Kaiser, had the audacity to, in that meeting, offer me the seat at the board of Siemens, which is, I think, something like a 200 to 400,000 euro job you would do. And I was sad then. I was like, he isn't being serious. And we knew he had press invited to then have a shared press conference to make it seem like we're all on the same side now, while they had not divested from that coal investments, right? And I think it's about anticipating that a big, powerful tool of division is compliments and putting people somewhere where they don't belong. And it was a horrible, like some of the worst awkward moments of my activism work was to tell that CEO that I was A, not going to take a spot at the seat, but B, I'm not going to go and do a shared press conference now for him having to tell the public that we're all friends now. But I think that is, you know, maybe a second method that we're really taking it, being skeptical about, you know, them taking parts of us while leaving the rest behind, and B, by thinking about people who are under the room. How would people who are not in the room feel about this right now? People out there fighting the hard fight, feeling about whatever's going on here. And sorry, just a thought, quick thing on the culture question that you raised. I think the most successful thing, and by the way, we are also struggling immensely. It's not like we're winning big time all the time. We are failing all big time in Germany as well. So there, you know, it's ups and downs as everywhere. But I find the most successful thing we could do in terms of culture shift is not talk about it. Like, we didn't go out and say, hey, we're going to indoctrinate your children, so they're going to get all, you know, we're going to provoke a whatever lesbian. But, you know, that's what they think, right? We didn't talk about it, but eventually we found that on tens of millions of breakfast tables in the country, children would ask their parents, so what do you do for work? And that was some of the most powerful thing we could do without having spoken about it. So I would say culture shift is a lot about trusting people that they go out and do good stuff, and keeping that in mind that most of the work that we do and most of the victories are unseen and unheard, because these are the small, complicated conversations you have on a family dinner when the children kind of come up, or maybe it's a grandparents or whatever. And then, however, I find that we do also have a job in mainstreaming something that will become mainstream in the future. So we needed the eco guys with all the weirdnesses and their solar crush to go out and do the solar thing for us to have it to be a mainstream energy source as well. So I have a huge appreciation for everyone who goes out and says, hey, I'm going to do these big, amazing meals for my community where there's no meat, or where we talk about clean energy, or where we talk about our tomato backyard gardening projects and our sourdough ideas. Because eventually we know that all these small kind of moments will feed into a larger culture shift. We need the avant-garde as well, and we need those guys to kind of take pride in it. But I would say, as a movement, let's choose our front lines carefully and make sure we don't divide anyone over how they live.
We're miles ahead of the game already with culture shift here today. This was the first gathering with bagels and guacamole in the history of the country. So we're, the culture is shifting fast, everybody.
John, you have the last word, and then we'll give people a stretch moment before we get into the workshop.
Okay, everybody pay attention. I'm going to try to loop all of this in and all of what they said and all of what I'm thinking into an answer that has some cognizance and coherency to it. But going to your question, dealing with nonprofits, and I'm saying this because it's real controversial because of what's happening down south with us right now. Sometimes the battle within the movement is just as strong and as fierce as it is with the companies that we're fighting. Why? Because, as I call them, the big greens, little greens, and in-betweens use this to control the action. They have an agenda that they want to do. You're a small organization. They don't mind co-opting you into that space because they're going to offer you funding to do the work that you do. And the way they get money is by claiming that we're doing this work on the front lines. We're doing the grassroots work, but it's not them. It's those nonprofits and those small organizations. And when it comes time to doing something, and here's a true story, one of the organizations that I work with, a friend of mine has in Texas, was asking for some money to get a grant writer so they could get more funding involved. And they were told by the head of this other organization, oh no, we can't do that. But if you want some flyers, money for flyers, or t-shirts, or banners, well, we can get you that. So they look at building their capacity using your work without compensating you for what you need so you can continue that work. The work is much broader than going out and protesting. It's about, as I said earlier, helping people, making people feel that they belong, that you're interested in them more than just for the climate. You're interested in how they live and how it be better. That's my big struggle in Port Arthur. How can we live better? So we have to focus on that. We have to make sure that there's funding for those nonprofits so they're able to do the work. And there are those out there that will do it, but you can't allow yourself to be co-opted in and be distracted from the real reality of the movement. Something Luisa said also is very cognizant to this, and it's because if we're going to have that dealing with cultural shifts and dealing also with the sacrifice people make in this movement to go and protest and do actions and all of that, we have to protect them. We have to make sure that they are protected, and also we have to minimize exposure. When I was on a trial that we had regarding whether or not I was going to be a part of that action, legally, an intervener, the question was asked of me by one of the companies, by Semper, well, how many people are in your organization? And my response was, the entire city is part of the organization. We represent all the people everywhere. If there's a problem that they bring to us, we do that. Well, we need a copy of your membership list and all of that, the dues that they pay. I said, we don't work that way. We don't give that out because that is proprietary information. See, that's a strategy. They always say that, or they redact the information so you can't get it. So here's what we do. We say, well, we can't give you that information. That's private. Those are people's information. You don't want anybody giving your phone number out if you don't want to have it because you don't want prank calls. So why do you think we would do that? So we have to protect them, but the leadership has to be strong enough to stand up and make people know of the sacrifices so that they will stay engaged, knowing that someone's out there fighting, but I've got all these people behind me. I've got all of them. I had a council member say once, I formerly served in the city council, and I was talking about something. He leaned over and said, John, I agree with you, but where are those people you're talking about? Because at those meetings sometimes, all is there is staff, and if you got four citizens, four or five citizens, you've done good. So it's hot button issues that they respond to, but we have to protect those people, make them feel secure in the movement. And if they are arrested, be prepared with lawyers and money to get them out and bail them out. Texas has some heck of a laws that they put in place this last session where if you interfere with critical infrastructure, like everybody remembers the freeze and how Texas almost fell, if you interfere with critical infrastructure, go and close a valve or shut something off or anything in that way, then you could be fined $100,000 and 10 years in prison. So that those kind of draconian moves limit us in terms of what we can do. But the way we address the culture, the way we address the relationships that frontline organizations build, get their hands dirty into the meat of the community on the ground, is that we have to make the people secure, and they have to have this funding, and they have to be independent on their own to do the work. Because if they aren't, they're just being used for somebody else to pad their bank account doing money on the work that you're trying to do. And that work is based on truth, authenticity, and also transparency. We have to all be on the same page, know and clearly understand what's going on. And if we do that, then all of these things, culture, profit, nonprofits and their funding and their work, and the sacrifice people make, people will understand. They will be ready to make that sacrifice because they know they're involved in making a better future for not themselves and not just their family and their children, but for all of us.
Thank you. So there's a lot of inspiration I can see in your heads. The heads are getting bigger and bigger. So let's just take a breather, and then Jamila and Evan is